In today's episode, I'm going to show you how we can make this Star Wars and Marvel collaborative composition. So let's check it out. What's up, everybody? This is Jason Ortega here with Blended Graphics. After today's video, we will have completed our first half of our 30 days of Photoshop. And what better way to wrap up this first half than to give you a tutorial on how to make one of my favorite Star Wars and Marvel compositions. So just about a year ago, I created this Star Wars and Marvel mashup composition, and looking back on it now, there would definitely be some changes that I would add to this. However, if you fast forward another 5 months, I decided I wanted to bring back this theme. I really enjoyed this, introducing the Marvel characters into the Star Wars universe. However, this time I wanted to do the opposite. I wanted to introduce the Star Wars characters in the Marvel universe, and I wanted to capture this with that iconic Avengers Endgame final battle sequence. And this tutorial is a bit of a long one, so if you want to get yourself comfortable, grab a drink, grab some food, sit back, relax, and let's enjoy this tutorial. Let's jump right into it. All right, so with our first image already loaded in here, the first thing that we want is our quick selection tool. And we only really want the foreground to this, so we're gonna use the quick selection to select the background and the sky. And then we can even zoom in here, and we can either hold down the Alt or Option key so we can bring back some of this foreground. And so we're just doing a little bit of cleaning here, tidying up, making sure that we include all parts of this foreground. All right, so we have just a little bit more here. And then we're going to touch up this left side a bit. Remember that we're holding down the Alt or Option key to bring back some of this land. So we'll just tidy up just a little bit more. All right, and now that we pretty much have that, we want to go to the bottom, click our layer mask icon, and then Command I to invert that so we only have the foreground. And now we can go ahead and bring in our next ground layer, and I'm going to use the rectangular marquee tool to just select this top part. I don't have to be too precise because we're going to blend it in. And once we have that, we can go ahead and click the layer mask icon once more and Command I to invert that. To save us some time so you don't have to hear me explain all the easy, boring stuff, I'm going to speed up this next section where I blend this in with our first foreground layer. Now that that's taken care of, we can load in our first background image that we're going to use. And we can slide this up a bit so we can see the whole image. We don't need the sky, so I'm going to select that and get rid of it. And once we have the sky removed, we're going to position these mountains and scale it up to where we want it. And then from here, we can load in our actual sky image that we're going to use for this. And I think these dark clouds are going to be a great fit for the composition. So right now, we're just going to move it around to just somewhere that's a personal preference, and I think it looks pretty good for us. So just a little bit more. I think this is looking pretty good. Okay, we'll hit the check mark. And now you can kind of see we have this little halo effect going on with our mountains. So to help us get rid of that, we're going to go up to Filter, scroll down to Other, and then click on Minimum. It's also important to note that you must be clicked on the mountains layer mask first before doing these steps. And once you're into this properties panel here, you'll see that the default is set to 1 pixel of a radius. More often than not, 1 or 2 pixels usually will take care of the halo effect. And what this will do, right now at 1 pixel, it'll remove or paint black 1 pixel worth onto that layer mask along the part where the black is meeting the white. And for this image, we're gonna change this to 2 pixels and hit OK, and that will do the trick. And then I'm gonna zoom in here just a little bit more. We're gonna remove the sky for a second, and we're gonna clean this up a little bit around the edges using a hard tip brush, kind of going back and forth between the black and white. But for this part, I'm gonna speed it up. All right, so now that that's cleaned up the way I want it to, I'm gonna start doing some color grading with the sky. In all of my compositions, I usually like to set the tone with my sky first and then have everything else kind of match that tone and temperature. So you're going to see a lot of different adjustment layers being used through this. I'm actually going to speed this up because it did take me a while to kind of get it at least to look the way I want it to. But anyways, you're going to see some color lookup tables, gradient maps, different solid color layers, levels, adjustments. So a lot of different tools to get this to look the way I want it to. So I'll see you in just a second. So you can see there were definitely a lot of adjustments made to set the tone of this sky. And honestly, that's just because, you know, I had this vision in my head of how I wanted it to look. But no matter what tool I was adding on there and making these adjustments, it still just wasn't quite coming out the way I wanted it to. So I just continued to build upon layer by layer. And eventually we got to a place that I was happy with. So we can go ahead and move on from here. I have also organized myself a little bit better as well. I won't talk too much about it, but you will see throughout the video that, you know, I'll color my layers and groups, and I do that in all of my projects just to help keep myself organized. But anyways, we're first going to jump into our mountains layer, and then we're going to add a curves adjustment layer. And within the curves adjustment layer, we're going to go to our blue channel, and we're just going to reduce that in the midtones a little bit, just to kind of warm it up to match our sky. That's our first step. Okay, and now we want to go ahead and add a brightness and contrast adjustment layer. And we're just going to play around with these sliders here. I think overall we want to lower the brightness a bit as well as our contrast. So we're just going to kind of play around with these until we get into a place that I like. Okay, and this is looking pretty good. From here, I actually want to desaturate the mountains just a little bit, so we're going to add a hue and saturation adjustment layer and clip it below. Also, pay no attention to that color balance layer. I realized that after the video was already recorded and I was going in to do all the edits, that no adjustments were actually made with that color balance layer. So just ignore that for the time being, because now we're adding another color balance on top of our hue and saturation layer. And now we're going to start to just move these sliders to, again, help us match the tones of our sky and help blend everything together nicely. I usually like to start off with a color balance adjustment layer when it comes to matching tones. I think it's a pretty efficient way to at least eyeball the colors that you're looking for and easily enough to, you know, maneuver the sliders to at least get a good foundation to work with. We will continue to build off of this with other adjustment layers, but this is a good starting off point. Photoshop is great in so many ways. It does have tools that will help you be more precise when it comes to matching colors. I honestly just rely on my own pair of eyes that I have and trust my instincts, and I usually like the way things turn out just by doing that. But, you know, it's all about personal preference. And we're going to close this up here now, and we're actually going to go back into our sky. Just because, like I said, this to me was probably the most difficult part of the composition just because it just wasn't looking the way I wanted to. The challenge that I had was I knew I was going to incorporate a lot of glows, and for those to be effective, I needed to have a contrasting background with the bright colors. So I'm back in selective color, and I'm actually going to speed this up just because I know there's going to be a lot more edits to this. So I will see you in just a second. Okay, now we're getting somewhere with this. It's starting to have that eerie look that I want it to. And for the sake of time, I'm just going to skip to the next part of this tutorial after every foreground color has been matched with our sky. It's just repeating those same steps of making sure our levels are correct, color balance, using selective color again just to help match the tones. But since you already got a little bit of a glimpse of what that process is like when I was working with the mountains. I'm not going to go ahead and continue to explain all this again with each and every one of these ground layers. So let's go ahead and just jump right ahead. So this is what everything looks like now that the colors have been matched. I also want to point out too, since we did add new adjustments to our sky layer, what we can do to help even things out with our ground layers is we can go into those individual adjustment layers with our sky, hold down the Alt or Option key, and drag a copy of that to attach onto our ground layers. That way we have the exact measurements, levels, and all of those different details as well, so things can match up pretty smoothly. So that's one method that you can use to help blend things together. Let's go ahead and continue. I'm going to add a solid color adjustment layer on top of our mountains, and I've just used the color picker to select one of our really dark tones throughout our piece here, and I'm using a cloud brush now to just paint some of that back in after I inverted that mask, and this way we're just going to give a little bit of haze. And we can see the before and after on that. This also helps separate our background from our foreground and give it a little bit more of that depth of field. And then we're just going to lower the opacity just a little bit on that and go back into our brightness and contrast layer of our ground and just increase the brightness so it's not so dark. And then I want to add a hue and saturation adjustment level on top of all of that just to desaturate this a little bit more. Okay, and I think somewhere around here is looking pretty good. And since we made the changes onto the ground, we have to do the same thing to our mountains. So we're going to adjust that as well so that things match up accordingly. And now that the background is finally looking the way we wanted to, we can go ahead and start to incorporate our characters. And to start things off, let's go ahead and drop in Yoda. And to remove him from the background, we're going to go ahead and use the pen tool. I like using this just because it's the most precise. And once you have an outline of that, just create a layer mask. And then we can just do this final touch up here and fill that with black. And we can go ahead and do the same thing now with our other characters. Repeat the same process using the pen tool, just go around. And once we have them selected, add the layer mask and that will remove them from the background. And here we are. Now we've got everyone in place. I positioned them already as well to where I want them to be. I'm also in the select and mask feature right now because I want to use the refine edge brush tool to go over Anakin's hair. I wasn't too precise with that with the pen tool because I knew this would be an easier method to remove that. So we're just gently going over the edge. And this is looking really good. All right, and so our output, we just want that to be on the layer mask and hit OK. And then we want to press Command T on our character group, and we're just going to scale this down and just do minor adjustments. And once we get this in place, we're going to have to start matching our characters. And we can add a levels adjustment layer to Obi-Wan Kenobi and Mace Windu, and we'll just increase the contrast to match our other characters. And then from there, we want to jump to Anakin and add a brightness and contrast layer and decrease both the brightness and the contrast on him. Let's now go ahead and add a color balance adjustment layer, and we can start tweaking some of these colors. Yoda's already looking pretty good, so my main focus is going to be on Anakin and Mace Windu and Obi-Wan. So we'll continue to move these sliders around and help match kind of those tones, not only with Yoda, but also with our background, obviously. And one of the other reasons I really like color balance is because sometimes, you know, you're not necessarily sure what colors need to be adjusted, and it's easy enough to just move these sliders around. And, you know, if you make a mistake and it doesn't look as good, well, just move it the other way. Sometimes it's all about trial and error and just playing around with it until you get it looking right. So we can see the before and after on that. It's just a subtle adjustment, but looks nice. And now we have to do the same thing to our other friends, so I'll speed this up and I'll see you in a second. All right, so I think we have a good starting off point with our characters. I will obviously go back in and do some touch up and add the effects to the lightsabers, but I want to go ahead and move on from these guys and we can bring in our first ship. So let's drop that in. And we're once again going to use our pen tool to create a selection of the ship and then click on the layer mask to remove it from the background. I'm also realizing at this point that I probably should have already done this in advance so that way you don't have to continue to see me repeat these same steps over and over again. But oh well, you at least now get to see a more detailed version of what my process is like. All right, so with that dropped in there, we're just going to scale out, press Command T on that. And we're going to drag this up to this top right corner and rotate it and just kind of get it to a spot, again, that just looks good for this composition. Okay, we're now going to have to revert back to our pen tool and just kind of get some of this area that I didn't choose and select the first time. So we can clean this up and remove this original background from this image. Okay, we can bring in our next ship and we're going to repeat those same exact steps using our pen tool to create a selection. And once we have that done, we're going to right click, click on make selection, and then click on layer mask and command T so that way we can transform this. We'll scale it down and just position it somewhere in the background since it's going to be further away. And we'll tweak this other one as well. All right, and I've already created a copy of our X-Wing, so we're going to drop this new one in here. And same thing, we'll scale this down and put this somewhere else in the background. And once this is in place, we're going to now bring in our second copy. And this one's going to be even further away. So obviously, the further away you get, the smaller the object it's going to be. So let's put this somewhere nice that fits well. At this point, I'm thinking that Mace Windu's lightsaber is just too close to this X-Wing, so I'm going to move him just a little bit to create more space between all of this. And before we bring in our next X-Wing, I'm just going to scale down our mountains even more so. Okay, so let's bring in our next X-Wing, and we have a toy model here that we're going to use, and we're just going to outline that and again, just extract this from the background. And this ship's actually going to be the closest to our characters. So we'll just move this to the right side and rotate it. I like to have a variety of these ships, not only to keep things interesting, but also to help enforce that sense of depth of field. Let's bring in our first portal, and we can put that into a screen blending mode. I've already made extra copies. And just like in the Avengers Endgame movie, where all of these characters are coming from these portals, I want to do the same thing, not only with our Star Wars characters, but also these ships. So I'm fast-forwarding this with our other portals that I made the copies of, and we're going to position this just to where I think it makes sense based on the relationship of where our ships are right now. And just a quick tip, if you want to make these portals pop even more, you can create copies of them, and that will just bring out these colors and make them a bit more vibrant. And just to be more detailed with our scene, we're dropping in some 3D assets of rubble that I got from Envato Elements, and we're just going to position these a little bit all over the place to help give that sense of destruction and war and the aftermath of all of these battles going on. And we just have a couple more piles that we're going to introduce. So we'll bring in our next one, put this in the bottom left corner. And then obviously, we're going to have to again go back and match this with our current ground layers that we have. And this is going to be our last one, and we're going to put this on the back right side somewhere. Okay, we can hit the check mark. And now on the layer mask, we're just going to remove some of this area from the rubble that we don't need. So we're going to do that with all four of these piles. Now it looks like these piles of rubber fit in with the ground a little bit better. We're going to remove all of our characters and we're going to use the elliptical tool here to create a selection, and we're just going to remove this part of the background because we need to show that other world that all of these ships are coming from. So we're going to fill all these layer masks with black after we create the selection. And we have just a couple more to go. And as I'm using the elliptical marquee tool, I'm holding down the Option and Shift key to create a perfect circle. You can also press down the space bar to move the selection once you kind of have it in place. So we just have this one last one to do. Okay, and then we can load in our new background layer that we're going to have, and we'll scale this up a little bit. And when originally looking for an image to use for this new background layer, I wanted to find an image that had a sunset in the sky just because I knew I was going to have warmer colors in my composition. So I wanted something that would help complement everything else going on within the picture. We can go ahead and close out of that, and we're going to add a new layer and clip it onto our rings. And I'm using an orangish tone, and we're just going to paint over the rings that we have. And I have this in color dodge blending mode. And what this is going to do is just make these stand out even more so and really help enhance that effect. So you can see how this is just really brightening this up a little bit. What I want to do is essentially just create more contrast with the portals and our current background. And we have just a little bit more to go with this. And we can see the before and after of this. It's a really nice addition that we added on there. We can bring back our ships. And for this next section, I'm actually just going to speed through it again because all we're doing is just matching the colors of our rubble with what we have on the ground. And you already know how that process works. So let's speed through it. Okay. We can go ahead and move on now, and we're going to start matching our ships in our background. First, I'm just going to adjust Yoda ever so slightly. And we can go ahead and add a levels adjustment layer to our Y-wing, which is the ship on the top right corner. And we're going to create some more contrast, so we'll bring in the shadows as well as increase the highlights a little bit. And then let's zoom in here, and I'm going to use the rectangular marquee tool just to select this part of the ship. Press Command-J to make a copy of it, and we're going to move it to the right side over here, since it was kind of cut off in that original image. And we're just going to position this to make it fit nicely, and we're going to clean it up a bit. And we can zoom in just a little bit more just to make sure that everything is lining up okay. All right, we'll hit the check mark. And then we want to paint away the black part of those edges there. And it's still looking a little funny, so we're going to go back to our layer mask and just touch up this a little bit even more so. Excellent. Okay, so now we can add a brightness and contrast adjustment layer, and we'll clip it on there, and we'll decrease the brightness from this ship. And now we're going to continue with our X-Wings and do the same thing. So let's load in a brightness and contrast layer. And we'll decrease that quite a bit. And then we can bring in a levels adjustment layer. And then again, just kind of bring in those highlights and shadows even more so. I'm going to make a minor adjustment in our brightness and contrast layer and darken it up even more with an exposure adjustment layer. Perfect. Okay, so then I'm going to apply those same adjustment layers to our first X-Wing, which is in the front right there. All right, and since our back two X-Wings are so close to those portals, I'm not going to really do any adjustments with that just because they're going to be pretty bright. But we can go back into our portal group now and we can start adding some glows. All right, so let's add a new layer, and we're going to find a nice bright color to start off with. And we're going to use a soft round brush, and we're going to set this to 20% opacity. And we're just going to slightly go over the areas of the rings. And then we can see a quick before and after of what that looks like. Good, we'll give this our first glow, and we're going to add another one. And we're going to find an even more saturated yellow to work with, and I'm going to put that in the bottom just because I like to have my darker glows at the bottom and then kind of build up to the lighter effects on top. And we're going to do the same thing. We're just going to go over these rings and again just to enhance this glow to make it really pop. And we can even turn down the opacity just a little bit here since it's a bit too much. All right, and since our background is a little bit too red for my liking, I'm going to shut off this color balance adjustment layer. And instead, I'm now going to add a hue and saturation adjustment layer and attach it to our background. And we're going to desaturate that quite a bit. Go ahead and press B on your keypad to bring up our brush, and we're going to use our right bracket to scale this up. Let's switch to a soft round brush, and we're just going to paint black on that layered mask to bring back some of that color by the mountains. All right, moving on. I'm not quite happy with how Mace Windu and Obi-Wan's looking, so I'm going to add a levels adjustment and just play around with those anchors a little bit and see if we can get something looking a little bit better. I apologize for all the moving around. This is just kind of how my process is. I see one thing after I'm working on a completely different part of the piece, but yeah. So we're going back to the portals now, and we're going to find another yellow to work with, and we're going to add another glow. If you've seen some of my other videos talking about glows, you know I like to do glows within the objects themselves, and then like to do an overall atmospheric glow, which is what I'm doing right now. And then I went ahead and pressed Command-J on that group and made a copy of it, so we can see that before and after of just duplicating that group itself. And I'm happy with how the portals are looking, so let's jump back to our characters. And we can first start off with Anakin, adding a color balance adjustment layer, and we're just going to add some warmer tones to this. And I'm just going to pause here for just a second for the sake of time. We're going to speed through this whole process of doing the color grading to our characters. Some things to be on the lookout for are the reflection of Yoda's lightsaber onto Anakin, as well as completing the lightsaber effect for everybody else. I will be back in a second. And we're back. Okay, let's go ahead and recap a second for everything that just went on during this speed edit. All right, so the biggest thing was the color grading process of all of our characters to help them match with their background. So we use a different variety of methods with that, using different solid color layers, color balance, and then we also worked with the reflections of our lightsabers to make sure that those glows are bouncing off of the clothing of our characters with Obi-Wan Kenobi, as well as Anakin. We had to finish up the glows on the lightsabers because that was removed during our cutout process of our characters. And when, like I said before, I do a lot of different layers of glows. So it wasn't just one overall streak. I don't know if you noticed that, but I used a couple of different colors when I added on the glows of our lightsaber. All right, moving on. We also added highlights and rim lighting to our characters from the portals to help interact with that. We still have more to go with this. We're going to start to now bring in some shadows for our feet, so that way it doesn't look like they're just floating on the ground. So let's go ahead and get to that now. All right, so here's one of my dust brushes that I have, and I'm just shrinking it down and painting black on the layer mask of Anakin, and we're just slightly going around his feet. I'm at 100% opacity. We're going around all of our characters. And I don't want to overdo it with this because I don't want it to look like they're actually sinking into the ground, but just enough so it looks like they have some dirt kind of brushed up on their feet. So we have just a little bit more to go with Yoda. We'll finish him off, and then we can add a layer mask on Obi-Wan, paint a little bit on his boot. And let's switch back to a soft round brush now, sample a dark color of this ground, and we're going to start working with our shadows. We can go into a multiply blending mode. I think that tends to work the best whenever you do any sort of shadow work. And we're just going to take our time with this, do a little bit around the feet here, again, to give that realistic impression that our characters are in fact in this environment. And whenever you do any work with shadows, the closest to the feet, the shadow intensity is going to be the darkest. And now I'm doing a little bit in between the legs. You will have some light that might be able to cast through, so the shadow intensity is not going to be as much as it would be closest to the feet, for example. Okay, and let's do a little bit of work on Anakin. And whenever you're doing shadow work, it's always best to know where your light source is coming from. For us, the light is coming from these portals in the background. So a lot of our shadows are going to be casted forward in front of our characters. In some instances, whenever you create your shadows, it can be as easy as making a copy of your subject, flipping them upside down, and in your layer styles, do a black color overlay and then reduce the opacity on that. You know, sometimes you can get by doing that. I personally like to create a more customized look to this and just really be more like go with the flow and take your time with this as we do this. There's no rushing to it. Play around with the opacities, play around with the flow percentage as well. I find it best when you slowly build up the effect as opposed to just rushing through it. I don't think it looks as nice. Shadows can be a tricky thing to work with. And, you know, sometimes it might take practice. Maybe you have a flashlight in your room and you can shine the light on some objects and see how that creates shadows. If you're walking outside, maybe be a bit more aware of how light is interacting with objects and how shadows are casted from that light. So all of that can be great practice if you're especially not as comfortable with creating and working with shadows. But anyways, let's go ahead and continue here. We're going to start creating some light from our lightsaber. So let's condense this brush tip and just paint blue after we sampled the color from our lightsaber. And we can reduce the opacity a bit, go into our layer styles, and bring in some of the darks from underneath to help blend things in smoothly. And now we're going to continue with the light reflection with our grounds. In our rubble layer, we're going to add a solid color adjustment layer. And we just want to find a good yellow that works with our portals, and we can put this into a overlay blend mode. And from here, we can adjust the color just to see what works well with our accent highlights. And after we've inverted that mask, we're just painting some of this back in on here. And similar to creating shadows, you know, we're trying to be cognizant of where the light is coming from and what parts of these rubble is going to be the most affected and have the most light cast it and reflect it off of it. You obviously don't want to do the entire bit of rocks on the ground, only little pieces of it that are maybe angled to the closest to the light. And this is where the hard part really pays off in the end, because all of these details really elevate your overall composition and the quality of it. I know things are a bit tedious right now, but like I said, the payoff is huge and all the details matter. And this is our last pile, so we have just a little bit more to go with this. And let's check out the before and after. Yep, I like it. Let's bring back our characters. And now we're going to do the same thing with a ground layer, so we can add another solid color adjustment layer. And let's just go through our blend modes and see what we like. So maybe we'll do soft light this time. And we'll invert the mask by pressing Command-I. And we're just going to paint some of this back in. We don't want all of it, just little pieces of it. And remember that our characters are blocking our main portal, so we're not going to paint too much of that back in front of them. That doesn't really make sense. All right, and then we can intensify this by adding another solid color adjustment layer. And let's click on that color again, and we're going to find just a little bit of a different color. Press OK, Command I to invert, and repeat that process of just painting some of this back into our surroundings now. And from here, we can find a good color to work with and paint another layer on top of our rubble. And that's going to be into an overlay blending mode. So we're just increasing the intensity of that just a little bit more. And I want to make that right side brighter only because if you look on Yoda, on our original image, he already had this really harsh yellow light coming from his right side. So in order to make that make sense with our background, I wanted to just give us the impression that there's some other light source away from the image that we can't see that's creating this light coming from the right side. So that's why I'm painting this light on the rubble and intensifying that even more. But let's go ahead and continue. I'm going to double click on our layer and we're going to use Blend If to bring in some of the shadows from underneath. And now that we got all of this looking pretty good, we can now shift towards our ships and start doing some color grading on them. So we're going to go into our first X-Wing here and we're going to use a color balance adjustment layer to clip it on. And we're just going to introduce some of those warmer tones. So bringing in those reds, bringing in the yellows, maybe a little bit of magenta. And we can do that with all of our three subcategories, our midtones, highlights, and shadows. So we can shift that to make it look pretty good. And to make this more realistic, we're going to add a path blur to give us the impression that obviously our ships are in motion here. So let's just angle this arrow here to a path that it would be coming from the portal. And then we can reduce the speed of this so it's not too extremely blurry. We can play around with our endpoint speed as well, and maybe even our taper. And then I always like to go ahead and introduce a little bit of grain when I'm working with our blur gallery. And let's press OK. Then we can add a solid color adjustment layer. And from here, we're just going to introduce some highlights. So again, find a nice blend mode to work with. Overlay always tends to be a good one to choose, and we can adjust the color a little bit. And then now that we're zoomed in, we can paint some of this back after we inverted that mask. Like I said, we're going to have some light source off the screen that we can't see. So the light from there is going to be reflected onto our ship. And then we will also have highlights on the back end of our ship as well as on top because of the portals. And we can exaggerate this effect even more by adding a second solid color, something even brighter, putting this one into an overlay blend mode as well. And we can paint over some of those original spots from our first solid color, and this will just help enhance that overall effect. And it doesn't matter whether I'm working with highlights, shadows, or glow work, I'm always constantly using multiple layers in different colors to help create the effect that I want. And what I want to create now are some streaks from our ship so it looks like it's moving extremely fast. So we can use a soft round brush and really flatten that tip, and using a very desaturated yellow, we're just going to go to the end, kind of angle it with our ship, and paint some of that in. And so now it looks like we have these little air streaks because our ship is moving so fast. Pretty simple technique, and it looks really good. And we can apply this to the rest of our ships as well. We're at the point in our composition where we can now add all of these little elements to help wrap things up nicely. So what I'm looking for now is a good dust brush to use to, well, create exactly what the name entails, creating some dust or sand. Just some effects that would make sense in our environment. So after we do a couple more dabs of this, we can go back into our brushes and find another one for some variety. And I'm going to speed up this next part just because it's repetitive procedures. So I'll see you in a second. And I'm back. So what I've just now done was I picked out a powder explosion brush that I created, and we're going to create a little explosion in our background here. So let's go ahead and do a little dab here. Perfect. And then from here, I'm actually going to drag in an explosion image that I have. So we'll bring that to the top and move this to the side after we scale it down a bit. And actually, maybe we'll tweak this up even a bit more. Something like this, I think, looks a little bit better. Okay, we can press enter. And then using a cloud brush, I'm going to paint away some of these edges. Then we can add a new layer on top, and using a nice yellow, we can help brighten this up even more. And then I'm going to move this even more just so it's not too distracting with our X-Wing right there. And then we're going to add another layer, but I'm going to select a color first because we're going to create a glow on top of this. So find a good blend mode to use, reduce the opacity just a touch, and then we can do a couple more dabs on top for a glow. I'm now going to add an Ember stock image, and we're going to put this somewhere behind our characters, and let's put this into a screen blending mode, and we're going to shift it off to the right side, just to add a nice little touch. So right here, we'll hit OK, and let's bring in a fire image and add some more fire elements to this. And this is going to go to the left side of our composition. And while pressing the Command or Control key, if you click on any of these endpoints, you can actually distort the perspective of it as well. So we'll place this somewhere here, hit the check mark. I brought another fire element in. However, this first one I'm going to bring to the back side of the rubble and just change the perspective to how it was originally. So we'll hit OK. Make a copy of our embers on the right side, drag this one over to the left to add on top of our fire elements. And we're just going to rotate this and move it to somewhere that makes sense for us. And we can top it off with a couple dabs of a yellow color for a glow. All right, let's hit that check mark. And now one of the last things that we're going to add before we move to the camera raw filter is we're going to add some engine glow fire effects to our ship on the top right corner, our Y-Wing. So let's go ahead and do that now. And this is going to be very similar to what we did with the streaks, where we're just going to condense a soft round brush and create an oval shape to use. And I'm starting out with just a blue color, and we're just going to do a dab on each side. And now we have to erase some of that from the ship that is in the foreground. So let's paint some of that back in. Excellent. So now we're going to shrink the brush and use a white color and make that closer to the ship to make it the light's core. And holding down the Alt or Option key of our first light's layer mask, we can drag a new copy to this layer so that way we don't have to repaint all of the ship back in. And I'm not really digging this blue color right now, so let's add a hue and saturation adjustment layer, clip it onto that group, and we're just going to mess around with the hue and find something a little bit warmer. I think this complements our tones in the background much better. So we're now ready for the camera raw filter at this point. I went ahead and merged all of our layers together by pressing Shift Command Option E for Mac or Shift Control Alt E for PC. And then you right click that layer, convert it to a smart object. And under filter, we want to click on camera raw filter. And this will take us to the filter that we're going to do our final adjustments with. And I'm not really going to talk through this portion, so I'll let you just kind of see what my process is like with the camera raw filter. And here we are with our final composition. I think everything came together nicely. This was by far one of the longer compositions that I've made just because of all of the elements incorporated with this image. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial. If you did, please give it a big thumbs up. And if you haven't done so already, smash that subscribe button and click that bell to stay notified. Thanks a lot for joining me for today's episode. I know it was a long one. I hope to see you again tomorrow with another video. Take care, everyone.